We're talking again about what the final pH of your dough is. We talk about water a lot too, right? I remember the first time I competed in Las Vegas. You know, I've been on this on the World Pizza Champions team for a very long time with Tony, and was the first guy from Chicago. And a lot of people scratched their heads, like, man, Chicago's got pizza? Like, really? Like, before it became a thing. But I remember when we came to compete in Las Vegas, first thing Tony told us is go out and buy your water. Don't use the water that comes out of the tap in Las Vegas. The water is really not that good, right? Kind of smells kind of well water, eggy a little bit sometimes. The stuff that you get at your hotel has already been filtered, which filtering the water, what are we doing? We add salt to it. There's a lot of things that happen in that filtration process, right? We're looking usually for our water pH to be somewhere about 6.1, slightly acidic. We don't want it on the other side. I got a bottle of water this morning, and it talks about the pH there on the other side. It's like 9.5 somewhere else. There, 9.5 or higher pH. That side of 7 is more alkaline, right? As human beings, we like things that are naturally sweeter. So the water companies are increasing to the alkaline side, so that water is more pleasing to our palate. If you go and make a dough with a water that's very alkaline, you're gonna see that your structure is more compressed. It's gonna look different. If you have your water that's too acidic, or you pulled it out of a well, or wherever it came from, right, you'll start to notice that that has an effect as well. My teacher, Graziano Bertuzzo, one of the headmaster of all the masters, right? He's the guy that trained Tony and I for the first time. And he would tell everybody when we would be in class, you know, you gotta go out and buy yourself a pH meter, you gotta get yourself a thermometer, a scale, all this other stuff. And there's always somebody that would be like, oh, this is just too expensive, I don't have all that. And he looked down and he says, hey, show me your phone. And the kid would pull out his iPhone. I was like, so you had enough money to go buy yourself the new iPhone, but something that's critical, like a mechanic having a wrench, right, to your job every day, you didn't have enough for that, right? pH meter is critical. I put a pH meter in everything. I was talking to somebody that was out, North Dakota, I forget where he was from, but somewhere, again, more rural, right? That sometimes water coming out of the tap comes from underground somewhere. We're in the desert here in Las Vegas. The water comes from very far away and it's stored in tanks underground. And that's why, again, all this process changes the water makeup. It's something really important. Go ahead. So what he's asking is, when you have water, right, and you put your pH meter and it comes out, I'm telling you, like 6 is a good spot to be at for your water, slightly acidic, right? Let's say it comes out at 8, 7.5, somewhere like that. Slightly alkaline, and we want to bring it the other way. How do we do it? How do we make it change? Get yourself some lemon juice, some white vinegar, and depending on how much water you're going to use, right, you're going to weigh out your water. We don't like to use volume measurements in our dose because, again, it could be a little inconsistent. Scale out your water, put your pH meter in there, you see that you're a little more alkaline, you're over 7, you want to go back down. How do we do it? Start adding a few drops of vinegar. Start adding a few drops of lemon juice. Swish it around, put the pH meter in there. Oh, it changed, it went down. Get it to the point where it's there every single time, right? Is that your answer your question?
To go down.
How do you bring it up?
Oh, how do you bring it up? That's another good point. When you have, let's say, too far to go on the other side, you do start to run into limitations, right? This is the point now where we talk about where did you source the water from? If it's coming out of your tap, that let's say it is really acidic, or you go to the grocery store and you buy a bottle of water, this is where you're gonna have to take some tests, some numbers. Most of the time, I haven't really seen a situation where I had to go up. It's always coming down to make it more acidic. And again, it's because the water companies wanna be more alkaline to make it more pleasing to your palate. When we talk about water softeners, what are we doing? We're again, taking some crappy water and we're trying to make it good, right? So what do? We put all those salt pellets and all that stuff in there. So yeah, it comes out, it's good, you could drink it, all that. You take a shower with softened water, you feel like your skin feels like a little slippery, whatever. It does the same thing inside of your dough as well, right? So you're gonna notice a difference if you use softened water. And we always say, try to stay away from it. If you're gonna make dough, you guys are still practicing and building for your dream pizzeria, or you're in a pizzeria and you're trying to make your dough better, right? Find where you're at. If it's feasible to go and get bottled water, get bottled water. But eventually you're gonna make so much dough that bottled water isn't a point. So to me, it's invest in a good RO, reverse osmosis system. Reverse osmosis, you'll have those parameters set up by whoever came out and gave you your system, right? If you can't get a straight answer out of the company that's giving you your RO system, keep shopping around, because it is a critical ingredient. The dough is the base for everything. You screw the dough up, I don't care what ingredients you put on top of the thing, it's still not gonna be a great pizza, right? So reverse osmosis is the way to go if you have to go that way. Let's say you're in the middle of nowhere, right? And you have to make the same thing happen. There is ways to do it. Again, reverse osmosis, bottled water, it is that important. Water is an ingredient. It's one of the largest ingredients in our formula compared to our flour, right? So pay attention to it. Give it some love, because it'll love you back if you get it right.
At what stage of maturation are you checking for pH? Is it something you should be checking frequently throughout the doughs?
So when I check pH on a dough, we don't really check it too much right out of the bowl, right? Because you kind of know what you're getting, right? It's gonna be kind of flat, hasn't done too much work yet. The yeast isn't really activated. But depending on how long that dough is gonna be around, right? If your idea is that you're making dough today and you're gonna use it all tomorrow, right? Awesome. Second day, pull the dough out of the cooler. Hopefully nobody's using that dough ice cold out of the cooler before they start making their pizzas and throw it in the oven, right? Nobody's doing that, right? We let it warm up, bring it to kind of room temperature, right? Yes, Leo. But that's really important. So if you're saying that you're shooting now for a certain pH and you're gonna start making this part of your brand, that your dough before you use it has to be X pH, right? Start measuring it around the time that you're ready to use it. Because let's say you start using that dough, you take a pH measurement and it's not down to the point where you want. Let's say it's still too close to neutral, 7, and you wanted it at 6, or you wanted it at 5.5. What do? Leave it out a little bit longer, because now the yeast will be working a little bit more aggressively as it warms up, creating more of that acidity, and then as soon as you pH it, you'll see I'm there. All right, this dough is ready to go. This dough is ready to pass. 48-hour dough, 72-hour dough. As you start figuring your process out, now that you got your water temperature right, your dough temperature came out right, your dough is stored in the cooler and it didn't screw up over the night, you know, and your dough is held properly, you're gonna start to know day in, day out where that dough is gonna be living. Take a dough pH at 48 hours, see where you're historically at, 72 hours, see where you're at. And again, if you see that at 72 hours you wanted to make a 72-hour dough and you're too acidic, well, what broke down? At some point that dough got too warm. Now you're talking about adjusting water temperatures, making your water temperature colder. So on your next test, you were at 62 degrees. Next one, try 58. And then do that same three-day process. Did it bring the pH down into that range where you liked it, where it's more acceptable, right? And it's really just testing. The guys that have nailed that process where they know every single day, they've got their check and balance list. Literally, it's like clockwork. It's no different than waking up in the morning and jumping on a treadmill. You know you're gonna do it every morning, right? Taking your dough pH will be part of your routine every day. Checking your starters. Your starters are ready when they're ready. You can't push them, right? Overnight, your thermostat on your air conditioner unit goes up, and all of a sudden overnight, you were 85 degrees in the pizzeria all night long when you anticipated 72. Right? Your dough, that starter is gonna be really aggressive much sooner than you anticipated. Can you still use it? Yes, but it's gonna have a little different outcome. How do you measure the pH of your dough? That's what you're asking?
Right.
So, if you have a pizzeria that you're opening, right? You got a fancy dish system, they still make you put that little test strip kit on the wall next to the three compartment sink, right? For your sanitizer and stuff. They call it litmus paper. Those of you who did great in science and biology class in high school. We had to use that all the time. I did it. I failed my algae twice. But
you never know it now.
Never know it, yeah. But so you get some litmus paper. You got to stick it in the dough. It's a little more difficult with the test strips, right? When we get a pH meter has two wires that come out. One is this kind of like plastic looking probe, like if you ever seen a travel toothbrush container, it's that big tube, like, right? It kind of looks like that. It sits inside this this solution to keep it in this perfect spot, right? It wants to sit around neutral and you can test it. The other side is a temperature thermometer, right? So you put both inside of what you're temping, or you're gonna pH, and what happens is you're creating a circuit, and that's how it reads what the pH is, right? pH meters aren't that expensive. I'm not telling you to go buy a brand new Escalade, right? Couple hundred bucks maybe. There's some really good ones that are out there. I've used Milwaukee is a really good one. ThermoWorks makes a really good one. If you see that it's gonna be the bargain brand $39 special, you kind of get what you pay for, right? Usually they're somewhere about 200 bucks.
And you're testing your dough ball, right? And then do you test it like at room temp, or is that a variable?
So it's a variable, but you want to define what that variable is, right? In Chicago, where I'm from, it could be literally 102 degrees today, and then tomorrow there'll be 12 inches of snow on the ground, right? There's a big difference in what happens ambient temperature. But how do we do it? We're gonna take, all right, my ambient temperature today is this, right? Take a pH, and this is where I was at, and this was the result. Tomorrow was a little hotter, it was a little colder. You're gonna start defining what all these numbers are. So you walk in today, you're making dough, the kitchen is 82 degrees, it's going to be a certain way, and you're going to set yourself up a certain way for that parameter. Tomorrow you walk in and it's 100 in there, well, you're going to have to react a little differently because the dough is going to go a lot faster, right? So that's really important. Again, it's the type of dough that I'm creating, right? If I'm doing what we would call pizza classica, the Italian style pizza that eventually turned into our American round pizza, like maybe from New York. New York pizza started out as kind of closer to Neapolitan with the, let's say the coal ovens, like if you go to Lombardi's or some of those historic, you know, first pizzerias, right? That's a certain type of dough, that's a certain type of pizza. Pizza Classica is more of that classic round, brown edge, crispy bottom pizza that we eat every day, right? Hand toss could be, right? Depends on where I'm at. Most of my doughs are not very acidic. I would say that a really good range would be anywhere from, I don't know, 5 to 6. If I was gonna play a conservative, give you a ballpark. That doesn't mean though that I'm not doing that Roman style at 80% biga or 100% biga, where all your flour and water in the first part, and all I'm doing on the second day is adding water, a lot of water. Right? That doesn't mean that that dough isn't going to be lower, 4.2, 4.5, right? But it's all specifically on what I like. This is what I created. If I was to go to Campo di Fiore, to me, that's my gold standard, what I'm shooting for.